This is Coding Math, episode 28, more on easing. In episode 27, we covered the basics of easing and tweening and got some basic easing happening. In this episode, I want to cover some refinements to the formula and then look at some other places we can take this. First of all, let's simplify the code a bit. In the initial example, I was getting the distance from the object to the target on each axis, then multiplying that by the ease value to get a new velocity, then adding that velocity to the current position. I separated out the steps to make this as clear as possible, but once you understand what's going on, you can simplify this code quite a bit. In fact, we can do this in a single line per axis. We just say position x plus equals target x minus position x times ease. And the same thing on the y-axis. To test this, I've set the event back to a click so we can see the resulting ease a bit more clearly. And as you can see, this works just the same as before. Now we can abstract this even more by putting it into its own function called easeTo. There are different strategies you might want to take in this. You could have an easeTo function that takes simple numeric values, or you could have it take objects that represent two-dimensional points with x and y properties. The latter would be more flexible, but for the purposes of this demo, the object version would suit our needs just right. So here's that function. And now in the update function, we can just call easeTo on each frame. And I don't think I need to actually show you that it still works in the same way. Next up, I want to talk about some optimization we can do here. As it is, this function will run continuously on each frame, getting closer and closer to the target. Now you remember when we talked about Zeno in the paradox, which supposedly proved that you can never arrive at a destination. Well, that paradox depended on the idea that space was infinitely divisible. That no matter how small a distance you have, you can break that down into two or more smaller distances. Now, current theories about quantum physics may or may not differ with that hypothesis. I'm not going to get into that, but it may explain why at least some of us can show up at places where we're supposed to be on time. However, when we get into the world of computer programs and the representation of distance in electronic memory chips, I can say with certainty that there is no infinity there. You take any number and divide it by 2 enough times, and I don't care what architecture you're running on, you're eventually going to run into the limits of the computer to represent a number that small. At some point, the number you're dividing is going to round off to 0, and further divisions are going to continue to give you 0. And now in this test here, I'm counting how many times I can multiply 1 by 0.5 before JavaScript just gives up and calls it 0. As you can see, we'll keep it up for about 1,074 iterations, and then the number is just too small to divide anymore. If you use 0.1 instead, that cuts it down to a little bit over 300 times. But even more importantly, in a world of pixels, even though we now have sub-pixel rendering, there's going to come a point where the difference between two positions that you draw an object at just isn't going to make any difference in what the final render looks like. If you look at that last iteration before 0 there, that number equates to a decimal point, 322 zeros, and then the number 1. That's how far the object would be moving on each frame, about 1 bazillionth of a pixel. In other words, continuing to run that code that does all those calculations and redrawing the object on every frame is not going to make much sense, because for all intents and purposes, the object has reached the target. Now, depending on your code, there are different ways you can deal with this. In the demo we've been working with, I'm just going to set a flag called easing to true at the beginning of the program. Then, before I call requestAnimationFrame, I just check the status of this flag. If it's false, then the function doesn't get called. No more animation. Now, we need a way of setting this flag to false when we get close enough to our target. What I'm going to do is return true or false from that easeTo function. True means that we still need to keep moving because we're not there yet. False means that we don't need to do any more easing because we're close enough. To do this, I'll backtrack a little bit and go back to getting the dx and dy variables for distance on each axis. Now, the most accurate way of handling this would be to use the Pythagorean theorem to get the actual distance between the position and the target, and see if this is smaller than a set threshold. But we don't necessarily need to be super accurate for this check. We can just say if dx is real small and dy is real small, then we're really close. But we'll have to use math abs to make sure we're actually checking the magnitude of the distance, not just a negative distance. So we say if math abs dx is less than 0.1, and math abs dy is less than 0.1, then we're close enough. 0.1 is 1/10 of a pixel, and below that you're not going to see much of a visible difference in any animation. In that case, let's just go ahead and set position x and y to the target x and y, and make it official and return false. Otherwise, we'll just go with the usual calculations and return true. Now in the update function, we set easing to the result of the call to easeTo, and we're pretty much done. But we will need to start easing again when we click the mouse. So, after we set the target, we say if not easing, easing equals true, and then call update. This will kick off the update and request animation frame loop if it's not already running. So we can run this, and of course you won't see any real difference, which is good. But the code is only going to run when it actually needs to, which is better. Now again, the specifics of how I did things here is only a specific example of how you might do it in one particular situation. You might do things much differently in a different application, or if you're trying to write some kind of reusable library for this, you might do things differently again. I'm just making sure that you get the concept so that you can do it the correct way for your own application. Now the final thing I wanted to look at in this video is some of the ways you can use this simple easing. Of course, you can use it to ease UI elements into place or ease them out when you're done with them, but there are other uses as well. I often use this very formula to smooth out motion based on user inputs such as mouse movements or even accelerometer changes. Rather than use the raw input to set the position or rotation or whatever property of an object, I use a bit of easing to go toward the input value. This results in a sort of averaging out or smoothing effect that can be pretty useful. For an example, I've set up a sample file here that's meant to be a steering control for some kind of racing or driving game or simulation. Here I'm creating an image element and loading a steering wheel image into it. When it's loaded, I'll call render to kick off an animation loop. In the render function, I translate to the center of the screen and rotate by the amount stored in the angle variable, which starts out at 0. Then I draw the wheel so it's centered on that center point. Finally, I have a mouse move listener event which takes the position of the mouse move on the x-axis and uses the utils map function to map that position to a range of minus pi to plus pi radians, which is equivalent to minus 180 to plus 180 degrees. So as I move the mouse to the left and right of the screen, the wheel will turn half a rotation to the left or right. Now if you're not clear about that utils.map function, check out coding math mini number 3, where we created that function. Now when we try this out, you can see that it works fine, but it's not very realistic. I'm able to turn the wheel way too fast. You can never turn a real steering wheel like that, so it just doesn't feel right. So let's slow it down with a bit of easing. Back in the code, I'll add a target angle variable, set that to 0, and then add an ease variable. I'll set the easing fairly low at 0.05. Then in the mouse move listener, I'll assign the result of that map function to this target angle instead of directly assigning it to angle. Finally, in render, I'll do the easing, saying angle plus equals target angle minus angle times ease. That should be familiar enough. Now I'm not going to worry about stopping the animation here, because in general the steering angle is constantly going to be changed, and usually won't get a chance to settle down anyway. So let's see how this looks. Much better, nice and smooth. Maybe not perfectly realistic, but well on its way, and not bad for adding a single line of code and a couple of variables. Now there's one more effect that I wanted to demonstrate with simple easing. Now in general, anything you learn from these videos, you're free to use however you see fit. You don't need to attribute the source, but if you want to, that's perfectly fine. But in this next demo, if you decide to use it on your site, I'd prefer if you didn't mention me. Just leave my name out of it. This is one of those cheesy effects that you see from time to time on sites. It's up there with the water ripple Java applet effect. Yes, that's right, we're going to make mouse trails. Now we'll start off with the same file we ended off in episode 27. This uses simple easing to have a single object ease towards a position object. That position is being updated whenever the mouse moves, so it has the effect of having the object follow the mouse around. But what if we added another object and had it ease to the first object, and then had a third object easing towards the second, and so on? We can do this rather easily for any number of objects using an array. Now here in the code, which is where we ended off in episode 27, I'll remove the position object and create a points array in a numPoints variable that I'll set to 10. Then I'll loop through and push 10 generic objects onto the points array, giving each an x and a y of 0. I'll clear most of the stuff out of this update function, and I'll restart it by creating a leader object. This will initially be set to the target xy position set by the mouse move handler. So the mouse will be the first leader. Then I'll loop through the points array, getting a reference to each point. Then I'll simply ease each point to the leader. And draw a circle there. Finally, I'll set leader x and y to the current points x and y, so it becomes the leader for the next point. And that's that. Let's see what it looks like. Okay, so we have 10 objects following the mouse around. Pretty nifty. Let's go back into the code and change numPoints to 100. Now we have 100 objects trailing along behind the mouse. Note that it takes a little while before they all make it out of the gate. We can tighten things up a bit by changing the ease variable to something higher. Let's try 0.5. Now, like a lot of these crazy effects, they were used to death back in the good old days of Flash. Who can forget Sluggy? Same basic principles going on here, but each shape is one slice of the slug. There are lots of other examples of this kind of stuff, and occasionally you'll still see someone doing this with JavaScript and CSS on a web page. There, it's pretty annoying, but there could be some cool uses for the technique. Maybe rather than drawing individual objects, you could draw lines between each one of the points, and then you'd have this kind of trailing string. Anyway, there's lots of things you can do with this. And that's all I'm going to cover for simple easing. Hopefully I've sparked some ideas into your brain. Next time we'll start on full-on tweening.